Have any new credible studies come out that have proven red meat and processed meat are safe to eat and are good for our health?
No, and that was a myth. Last year, the Annals of Internal Medicine, which has become, it's like the National Enquirer of medical journals. They're all pretty bad, but this one is like the bottom feeder. And there's some reason to believe that the reason the journal prints this garbage is because it draws a lot of attention to them, and then their standing in terms of goes up in terms of medical journals. But those studies, I analyzed those studies, and I wrote an 8-page article about it. And the studies actually showed that reducing red and processed meat would save 353,000 lives in the United States alone, and in terms of deaths, and reduce the incidence of cancer, diabetes, heart disease. So, you know, you can report things differently. The same data can be reported differently depending on how you read it. One author agreed with me, by the way, and he tried to stop the publication of the articles. He was involved in the analysis, and he said, I was actually involved in crunching the data, and it would be inaccurate to report that there's no need to decrease the intake of red and processed meat. Interestingly enough, the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine has filed a complaint with a district attorney in Pennsylvania alleging reckless endangerment, that the journal this time had gone so far in publishing garbage without the disclosing conflicts of interest. They never forced the guy, the lead author, to disclose his conflicts, which were huge. But giving the idea that doing this very dangerous thing, eating red and processed meat, is okay. So we'll see what happens, but I'm not a particularly litigious person under normal circumstances, but I'd love to see that go through the courts. I think it would be a very interesting case. And it might make medical journals and the media more responsible.
What do you recommend for whole food plant-based eaters who complain of gastrointestinal pain?
Well, you can be a whole food plant-based eater and still have gastrointestinal pain for a variety of reasons. You know, maybe you've taken antibiotics and wiped out your gut microbiome. Maybe you were still eating a high-fat diet. I've seen people eat exclusively plant-based diets with 40% of calories from fat. You're going to be uncomfortable regardless of where the calories are coming from that way. You can still be overeating. Some people don't realize that people have different tolerance for some foods. And I'm not talking about this food allergy nonsense that a lot of people get into, but I'll just use myself as an example because it's easy. I really love cabbage, and I can eat about as much cooked cabbage as I want to. But when I eat raw cabbage, you know, like the red cabbage they put in salads, which I love, I have to be really careful because if I eat too much of it, I look like I'm pregnant very quickly, right? So do I eat red cabbage? Yeah, but I'm pretty mindful of that so I don't end up uncomfortable. That doesn't mean cabbage is bad for me or plants are bad for me. It's just a little thing for me because I watch people at my office eat a half a head of it. It doesn't bother them, you know? The same thing could be true with beans. You know, some people can eat, you know, 3 cups of beans. Other people, about 3/4 of a cup is the limit. They start to get pretty gassy. So you have to look at that type of thing too. But you may have unresolved gastrointestinal issues that like your microbiome isn't going to fix itself. You have to take probiotics to do that. So lots of reasons why that could be going on.
In chapter 5 of Food Over Medicine, what did you mean by the dietary establishment?
The dietary establishment is this incredible partnership between government, USDA, for example, food companies, agricultural organizations, dietitians and nutritionists and doctors, who all partner to keep a narrative going that basically says you need animal foods for protein. Moderation is the key. You know, and all of these statements are designed to either promote a particular food. Dairy builds strong bones, right? Or to promote a narrative that says you can essentially eat anything as long as you do it in moderation, which is insane because if you eat a diet that is comprised of all bad stuff in moderation, it adds up to a bad diet. And while you may have only had chocolate one time and fast food one time and 3 soft drinks this week, and you add it all up and you just were not eating a health-promoting diet. And the reasons for this, all of this, is economic. You know, these the ag businesses are very wealthy. And they buy academic centers in universities. They buy healthcare professionals to speak for them. In fact, back to the question about red and processed meat, there was an article after the Dietary Guidelines Committee meeting, one of the things that came out from a lot of the experts is you have to eat animal foods for choline. And so shortly after that, an article appeared in the British Medical Journal written by a nutritionist who echoed this. And of course, it's in a medical journal and she's saying choline is important. But aside from the fact that her article was easy to take apart, she was on this part of this organization called the Meat Board. And I went to her blog and I read her dietary recommendations. She's associated with people who pay her for this stuff. And she says, you should eat slab bacon instead of streaked bacon. I mean, if you looked at her dietary recommendations and where she was funded, you could see why she was saying this. So this is the type of thing that goes on to keep the narrative going that you need protein, you need particular foods, and all of them are good as long as they're consumed in moderation.